Today we're taking an up-close look at the iPhone 15, and I mean up-close. Enhance. Check out the dynamic island. At this magnification, we can see the individual LEDs that make up the pixels. It's truly marvelous. In case you missed it, we already did a teardown of the iPhone 15 Pro Max, complete with a detailed blog post analysis, repairability score, X-rays, and fancy pants wallpapers. Go check that out if you haven't already. We had a couple of partners on this teardown. Thanks to Evident Scientific, we had a microscope in the office this year, and all our zoomed-in shots came from the DSX-1000 they kindly allowed us to borrow. And as always, our friends at Creative Electron provided us with a preview of the innards of the iPhone 15 through the magic of X-ray vision. Not much looks different, but we won't know until we get started. Let's dive in and take a closer look. First up, let's remove those pencil-lobe screws. Enhance. That's 1 ounce and— oh god, what is that on the screw? Unenhance! Unenhance! Maybe I don't want to use the microscope anymore. Alright, let's get Clampy set up and open up that back cover so we can take a closer look at that adhesive. Stretch and cut through with a pick. With the back off, we're going to remove the battery cable bracket and disconnect the battery. Let's remove the wireless charge coil assembly cover and press connector 2. The inside of the vanilla 15 doesn't look all that different to the insides of the vanilla 14. We still access most of the internals from the back, and we still have the placeholder on the American version, where the SIM tray would be found in the international versions. Let's take a closer look at the battery press connector. The two larger pins are gold-plated copper contacts, right side being ground and left side supplying power. The two tiny pins on the top right and bottom left are probably data pins used by the battery management system. The Taptic engine is next, easily accessible with only a couple of screws and a press connector holding it down. We couldn't help ourselves, we had to delid the Taptic engine and take a closer look. The electromagnet in the middle flips polarity, driving the magnet in the center of the Taptic engine itself back and forth. The Taptic engine is followed by a few more screws holding the lower speaker down. Rumor has it that this microphone is now repairable in store. This repair is only being offered on the vanilla 15 and 15 Plus, but we hope that all iPhones will get the same treatment next year. Let's get that battery out next. There's two pull tabs tucked away at the top edge of the battery, and they're not easy to get to. Removing the camera assembly won't help because of the metal bracket sitting between the camera and the battery. Let's zoom in and watch those adhesive strips come out. The first pull tab snapped, but the second one is good to go. It goes on, and on, and on. With the battery out, we can see it's a 13.132 watt-hour lithium polymer pouch, and it has a new message for us this year. Warning, trained technician serviceable only. Let's move on to the upper assembly. There's a few brackets and press connectors that need to be undone before we can remove the front-facing camera and one of the millimeter wave antennas. The main camera is up next. That's another few screws and a couple of press connectors. Let's zoom in on the optical image stabilization and check out the sensor stabilizers. The electromagnets on the side of the sensor, not visible here, are working overtime to keep everything as stable as possible to filter out any vibrations or shaking while you're grabbing that perfect shot. Flipping it over reveals the 48 megapixel image sensor itself. Enhance. At 1640x magnification, we can see the quad pixel or photosite clusters that turn visible light into electrical signals that are processed and converted into an image. Another interesting tidbit, even though the vanilla 15 and 15 Pro Max each have a 48 megapixel main camera, the quad pixel buckets in the vanilla 15 are around 22% smaller, meaning it doesn't perform as well in low light conditions. Zooming back out, we need to remove that upper speaker assembly and all the screws, standoffs, and cables holding the logic board down. Flipping the logic board over reveals two more brackets covering two cables. You'd normally remove those by removing the screen, but they're accessible from the back too. That's definitely a plus for repairable design. New to the entire iPhone 15 line is the USB-C port. With two screws on one side, a standoff and screw on the other, and two more screws holding the USB-C port to the chassis, this thing is a bit fiddly to get out, but a sight easier than removing the ports on any of the Pro models. With that, our teardown is complete. We're still as impressed as we were last year that Apple pulled off the dual-entry design on these phones. It's a great win for repairability. Add to that the ever-increasing number of modular components, and on paper, it seems that these phones are more repairable. Unfortunately, parts pairing remains a problem on all Apple devices, acting as an artificial barrier against independent repair. We recently had to rescore the iPhone 14 from a 7 down to a 4 out of 10 as we incorporated parts pairing into our revamped scoring rubric. And so, with the expectation that parts and manuals will be released in the near future, we've given the iPhone 15 a provisional score of 4 out of 10. While the modular design is a definite repairability win, part sparing remains a huge obstacle, just as we saw in the iPhone 15 Pro Max. We're continuing our part sparing tests on the vanilla 15, and you'll find the results of those tests over on our blog.